welcome, everyone. I hope you've been enjoying the event so far. The title of this small demonstration is Zero Trust and How to Secure APIs with OpenID Connect. The idea is rather simple with Zero Trust. Once you're inside the corporate network in a perimeter, nobody has trust. You should assume that anyone that you're talking to is not trustworthy. So then the immediate question is, okay, well, how do we establish trust? And one of those mechanisms to establish trust is OpenID Connect. So we will discuss its history, its applications, and do a small demonstration where we show three use cases for OpenID Connect. So to begin with, what is OpenID Connect? Well, it is a standard. It is based or built on top of OAuth and JWT. JWT stands for JSON Web Tokens. Chances are you've already used it today. Anytime you've used any application or product or service out there that says, hey, would you like to sign in with your LinkedIn account or with your Google account or with your Yahoo or Facebook or any account whatsoever, chances are you've used OAuth and OpenID Connect. What's usually happening here is that you're authorizing someone to use something that belongs to you. For example, LinkedIn say, hey, would you like me to invite people that you know? Or would you like LinkedIn to go ahead and get your contacts from your Yahoo account, for example, and send them an invitation, say, hi, I'm on LinkedIn. Would you like to connect with me? So this is you authorizing someone to do something with resources that belongs to you. OpenID Connect takes this a step further and introduces an authentication, which means now it's almost like a password. I get to know who you are, and this has some useful applications as well. Additionally, the standard introduces some other functionality, such as establishing a session. That way, if you're accessing resources once or twice, in this case, an API, for example, you don't need to give that authentication authorization every single time. That is convenient. It does have the session management in addition to a logout. All right, let us continue. What can it do for you? Well, in the context of protecting APIs, we can tell the APIs who you are. So we can find out who you are as a proxy between you as a gateway, between you, the consumer, and the APIs. And then we can also help those microservices and APIs figure out what you can or cannot do. And as I mentioned already, we can do session management. So why is this good for API security? There are other mechanisms. We can use certificates, for example. We already heard of using API keys with all caveats that comes with. Well, the number one is it is a widely adopted standard. There are a lot of providers out there. I'm sure you've heard of them on something like Active Directory or Cognito or Auth0 and the like. So because there are quite a few implementations of it and vendors for it, and it's ubiquitously available, you will improve the security with it being a standard and improve the chances of it being adopted. And with an identity provider, you usually centralize all the access controls. That means that we don't have to define our access controls and all the consumers over and over in the API gateway and all the systems that we have. Instead of centralized, for example, if someone leaves the company, we can go to one place and say, well, all the access that person has is now gone. Furthermore, we reduce the risk. I just mentioned using API keys, for example, and that will be a thing of the past. Instead, with OpenID Connect, typically you have a token issued to you, which is a short-lived credential that is used for a period of time and then is no longer useful. So let's say it leaked by chance. Well, that token only has a certain amount of lifetime. And once it's over, it's not something that can be exploited. So here is a sample use case that shows one of the many flows that OpenID Connect can help you implement. If you take a look at this diagram, you'll see the actors in the flow. A consumer that wants to consume some type of API, usually we call it an upstream. An upstream is a name that we use interchangeably with an API or microservice. And the gateway typically is where we do all the protections for those upstream services. And we introduce this player called the identity provider that will help the proxy figure out if the consumer can or cannot access those upstream services. and a flow, the authorization code flow, goes something like this. The client comes to the gateway and says, I would like to access or make this request. The gateway says, okay, please go to the IDP. So the IDP can figure out who you are and let me know. You go ahead and get directed to the IDP. You exchange whatever information you would like. Maybe even you apply two-factor authentication, for example. And then you redirect it back to the gateway with that token that we talked about. That token is taken by the gateway and validated from the IDP. And finally, we let you through to access the upstream service. Now, this is one flow. There are a few others. And we will demonstrate those today. I will begin by showing you the authorization code flow. And then we will switch from there to a bearer token, which is another mechanism that a consumer can identify themselves to the gateway. And finally, we'll do something interesting, which is we are going to inject a header, which is a bit of information that can be useful to an upstream service when they're dealing with a consumer. Now, before I jump into this, I want to warn you that OpenID Connect can be a little complex, and this is just a short presentation, 20 minutes, to give you an idea about it. If you go and read any of the documentation or specifications out there, don't be surprised if you see these terms, IDP, AS, etc. This basically defines the identity provider. The resource owner, the resource consumer, is the person trying to access something, in this case, an API or microservice. The resource server, where the API or microservice actually live. And finally, the relaying party, which in this case is the gateway. And the gateway can also be thought of as a proxying resource server. Okay, with all the foundation out of the way, let's now go and do a demonstration. I will first show you the gateway and where we can have configurations for an upstream service and how to protect it. If you're not familiar with this user interface, not to worry. This is the administrative user interface for the Con Gateway. In here, excuse me, we can register all the upstream services that we work with. And then we can decide how to expose them. And once we decide how to expose them, we can say, right, let's apply policies of any level. In this case, I'll show you a policy specifically for working with an identity provider called KeyCloak. And this basically protects anyone who tries to access this path by saying, hey, KeyCloak with a key. So if I click on view over here, you can see I have the OpenID Connect policy being enforced. So let's see this in action. A typical consumer will go to the gateway and say, I would like to make this request, OIDC, KeyCloak. I think I spelled this right. So you notice what happened is I got access. The reason for this is I was preparing for this demonstration. I already logged in. So let's try this again by me closing my browser. And in this case, all my cookies will be flushed and I will be challenged. This is an example of a person-to-machine communication where this person will now be authenticated and authorized. So I'll go ahead and put my username and my password. Notice I got redirected from the proxy. And once I log in, it will redirect me back into the proxy. And you will notice here we have this token. This is basically the identity provider telling the proxy, here you go, here's the information I know about this person. Let me show you what that looks like. It's using the standard JWT. So if I copy it from here, and I go to jwt.io. It's a self-contained envelope, and you can see all the information that identifies the person who's trying to consume the service here. Notice, for example, that you can see the same email address that I put, and it shows up right there. So this is a short example. I'll repeat once again, a consumer goes to the gateway. The gateway says, you cannot access this resource without me knowing who you are. We go to the IDP. The IDP gives me that token. The gateway sees the token, figures out who you are, and lets you in. But let's take another example. Let's assume you already have a token and you want to come to the gateway, and then you want the gateway to once again let you through. We'll use a different user interface to test this use case. It's a classic testing tool. I'm sure you've seen something like this. This is called Insomnia, and you can use any others that you like. So in here, what I will do, let me for a second here clear my history. There we go. What I'm doing here is I'm going to the gateway and getting a token, which is here. And then I'm using that token that I got from the IDP, and I will pass it to the gateway. And I will do this in this step here. Notice I'm getting the response that I've gotten before. Same thing happens. The gateway is able to take the token and introspect, in this case, figure out who I am and then let me through. So let me go ahead and send this through. And you'll notice once again, I'm able to get a response. So these are two use cases that we've done so far. Let me switch back to the browser and then we'll do a third interesting use case. Let's assume that there is something in this token, in the information we know about the user, that may be necessary for an upstream service to look at. So if we take a look over in this token, you will see that we have a scope with information about this user. A scope is a way for me to say, well, these are the application that this user has access to. Remember, we talked about authentication and authorization. Well, here's a benefit right there, is what are you authorized to do? Now, the gateway has access to this information. What if we can extract this information and give it to a service upstream to say, hey, look, I authenticated this user, and yes, the token is available for me, but also here you go, here's some more information so that you as a service can take advantage of that. So let me show you exactly how we do that right now in the gateway, where we modify it to inject this information. I will make it visible in here. You don't see right now if I search, for example, for a scope, it is empty, nothing there. But I will modify our configuration in such a way that I can let that upstream service get that information. So let's head on over to the user interface that I showed you earlier. And in here, I will make a small modification such that I can make this information available. So OpenID Connect, edit. And we do have over here an option to specify what component of the plugin, or excuse me, of the token we want to make visible and what to name. It's called header claims and header names. So let me save and update my configuration. And I'm done. Now if I go and I try to access this information again, I will now have a scope available for me with this information. This means that whatever upstream service I was working with now has this information. The benefit of this is obvious. We don't have to write code over and over. We don't have to maintain it over and over. And it makes it that much faster for the developers of the upstream services that I have to get their work done. And that is all. I covered the three use cases with their benefits.